White nationalism and political extremism in the Granite State. Where do we go from here in a post-Trump America? Next on The State We're In. Hello, and welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. Just 2 weeks after rioters stormed the nation's capital, security forces are on high alert across the country, as well as in New Hampshire. Thankfully, there's been no violence since the insurrection, but that doesn't mean the threats posed by extremism and white nationalism have gone away. With the inauguration of President Biden and a new administration, we want to know, where do we go from here? Dr. Christina Cliff, Assistant Professor of Political Science and Security Studies at Franklin Pierce University, is here today to discuss extremism in New Hampshire and what comes next. Welcome, Dr. Cliff, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So white nationalism and extremism is not new to New Hampshire. Can you walk us through some of that background? What groups do we have here and how active are they? What's some of the history there?
Yeah, New Hampshire and New England region in general has a long history of having some level of extremism and white nationalism. Some people will remember a few years ago, a man in Maine trying to start a new white homeland. What we see now, we do have some organizational groupings, Oath Keepers, Proud Boys, things like that, a few white supremacist organizations, but they're not the old school groups like we used to see. What we see much more often now are people connected via belief systems, but it's not a functional organized group per se. There's no membership, there's no joining, there's no meetings.
So what does that mean then in terms of like, I mean, how do they usually talk to each other? How do they, are if they're not organized, are they any more or less of a threat, do you think, than others in other states? What do you think about that?
So what we're really seeing is, to be probably overly technical, decentralization. And what it just means is that people are chatting. They'll chat in online spaces. They will meet up in real life, but it's not this functional organized group. If for folks that have seen the movie Black Klansman, for instance, the KKK used to issue member cards. We don't see that anymore. But what you also see is that it's not location specific. That means that, you know, extremists in New Hampshire will chat with extremists in Michigan, will chat with extremists in California. And so it's actually a much larger network in many ways than historically it would have been. There's both positives and negatives in terms of security concerns in that manner. Then, you know, we see a lot less sort of group formation, again, with those, you know, sort of notable exceptions of Oath Keepers, Proud Boys, et cetera. But that also means that individuals may choose to act on their own. They may decide that they need to follow their beliefs in a manner that is more reminiscent of, say, what we would think of as a mass shooting incident, Timothy McVeigh, for a historical example.
And what would you say? I mean, are these, I know nationally these groups are on the rise, but that's not new either. Can you talk a little bit about this sort of the rise of these groups and maybe how it relates to New Hampshire? Like in terms of numbers, like the them growing or becoming a little more of a threat than they have been.
Well, I don't know necessarily if they're more of a threat than they have been. I do think you're seeing more people connect with extremist ideologies, with extremist beliefs, and that's due in part to the pandemic. People are online so much more now than they were even a year ago. And so you're seeing people connect with extremist belief systems, extremist ideologies in much greater numbers now. And that doesn't mean that they're fully adopting extremist beliefs, But that is a very real concern right now, is that the pandemic is creating an environment where people are really uncertain, they're looking for answers, and they're going to potentially run into extremist content. New Hampshire and New England in general has this sort of backbone of libertarianism and individualism. Those are not bad things in and of themselves. However, they are sort of these avenues where people can tap into or come into contact with extremist beliefs. So, for instance, if you believe that the government mostly should not be able to regulate what you do, well, then you might bump into people online that are talking about being more anti-government than perhaps you initially are. And you can fall into these sort of conversational traps where now you're all talking about how bad the government is, it gets worse, it gets more extreme, and there's not a really good exit ramp for people at that point. And that's really one of the things we need to look at.
So let's talk about that a little bit more, that this the idea of an exit ramp. What is there something that can be done to offer people that exit ramp, or talk that through a little bit?
Yeah, so there's some really good organizations out there that help people get out of extremist groups, but they really are very much focused on groups. So, for instance, you know, former white supremacists, there's organizations to help them get out. There's people that'll work with them. But what we don't have really is a good plan for how to help people sort of de-escalate their beliefs. We don't have good tools in place for people that, oh man, I ran up against, you know, spent some time with this extremist content. How do we get them, especially when they realize that they've gone too far, they don't believe in the same things, how do we help them walk that back without creating a stigma that makes them essentially isolated even more than they were before?
Has there been any model that's successfully done that? Is there any kind of plan that would successfully do that?
It's a really hard question. You know, there's a couple of different things you can look at. You can look at what can we offer counter programming, particularly on the internet. We know that disinformation and misinformation is incredibly dangerous. Is there counter messaging? And we have seen that a little bit be successful in other countries, for instance. But the trick here is to find credible people who, you know, people that are tapped into extremist networks will see as credible and believable and relevant to their own messaging.
And along those same lines, just looking at the broader picture, you know, we know that these groups exist here. I mean, not organized groups, but this ideology exists. What do we as community members, what do leaders of our state, how do they address it? How do we as communities address that?
Yeah, I think there's definitely some steps that can be taken. First of all, you have to have a fact-based approach to anything, and recognizing and reiterating facts. The other part of that, though, is that we have to be willing to say, no, that's not a fact. And that's a really important, you know, sort of counterintuitive approach. Now, this is not to say that every time you hear somebody say something wrong, you should confront them. But we do need to have a consistent, coherent message from leadership, from, you know, that includes government leadership, but that includes community leaders, that includes community influences. That can be the churches, that can be, you know, social groups, that can be your town Facebook page, that can be from the political leaders themselves. The other thing I think we need to do is we need to recognize it is here, it is probably some of your neighbors, some of your coworkers, and recognize that we're the old school signs that we might have thought of, sort of the obvious signs, are probably not there. So you really have to be an active listener and engage with people to understand where they're at. because until you understand who is buying into extremist beliefs, we really can't help them walk them back.
And speaking of that, how should we be talking about extremist views and ideas, whether it's in the media or with our kids or in our schools? And why is it important to talk about it?
So I think one of the really important things to understand is that you absolutely can disagree with people. Not everybody has the same opinions. Not everybody has the same approaches to things. But when you are excluding people, when you are creating beliefs that are deliberately not just exclusionary, but hostile to another group of people, now you're heading into extremism. And that's where it can get incredibly dangerous. And if you're talking to kids, you know, little kids completely understand what it's like to be left out at recess or left out at lunch. What extremism does is creates pockets of people that are consistently left out of recess and left out at lunch. And they're hostile to those people. It's not just, oh no, you know, we don't play with that kid. We're going to make fun of that kid as well. And if you talk to them about that and they understand how hurtful that is, then they'll understand why extremism is dangerous.
So picking up on one of the threads we were just discussing, and this is something that President Biden called for, he's calling for unity, you know, in his inaugural address. Do you see the possibility of a dialogue opening up between people with extreme political and ideological views? And how does that happen if you do see that opening?
It's incredibly hard. I think we all know people that are locked into their belief system. I don't believe that there's any such thing as an unredeemable person, but I think sometimes you have to wait for those people to choose to be redeemable. What I think for a lot of us that study this kind of research is the vast majority of people are sort of on the fringes of extremism. Like they're sort of tapped into it and they get into this, you know, chat group or group environment where they feel a sense of community and a sense of connection. Those people are very reachable now. With that said, if you engaged in violence, if you engaged in hate crimes, if you engaged in extremist behavior, not just extremist beliefs, but extremist behavior, there has to be accountability. And without accountability, essentially we're saying, well, we're going to let this pass. So I do think there's avenues for discussion, but I do not think we have to say, well, that was bad. We want to move past it. So let's just let it go.
Mm-hmm. And do we have a sense of how many people are we talking about? What percentage of people do you think are embracing extremist views right now? Do we know the answer to that?
We really don't. But some of the data seems to suggest that it's a substantially higher number than we would like, that people are buying into one or more false narratives, and that's really driving their pathway to extremism. I think the best example was the data recently released by some polls that said that, you know, upwards of 60 to 70% of Republicans believe that Donald Trump won the last election. That's factually inaccurate. But if you believe that story, if you believe that inaccuracy, that's one step to believing that the government is illegitimate right now. And that if you are willing to act out against the government, now you're reaching that extremist horizon.
That's interesting. And what advice do you have for media in covering extremism in New Hampshire? In other words, how do you cover it without repeating the misinformation? You know, like, and how do you talk about these groups or these ideologies? What advice do you have?
Yeah, it's a really difficult question because, of course, we need to talk about it. We have to have it as part of our conversation if we want to combat it. The flip side to that, of course, is you do not want to give them publicity and you do not want to give credibility to their arguments. And so one of the things I always recommend is, if possible, reach out to experts on particular groups or particular ideologies, if possible. There's a lot of people doing research on extremism. Most are extremely willing to talk to the media about their specific interests and findings. And so, you want to be really, really careful, and this is true for anyone, of platforming extremist ideas. The minute you give it more oxygen, it has the potential to grow.
And finally, looking ahead, what do you think we'll see when it comes to extremism in New Hampshire? What do you think is the future there?
I would really like to see the New Hampshire government, the state level government, take it seriously. I don't know that we have. In fact, I know we haven't in New Hampshire and New England in general. I think we stick to the stereotype that, oh, this is a, problem for the South, or this is a problem. I'm originally from the Pacific Northwest. This is Idaho and Montana. This can't be here, but it is here. And if we're not going to, take it seriously, the potential is that you have an incident, a violent incident that we could have stopped or maybe could have prevented if we had just paid a little bit more attention to it on the ground in our backyard.
And what would that look like? What would taking it seriously look like? What at a government level, what would they do?
Well, I do think we need to recognize, and the Department of Homeland Security and FBI have done this, have recognized that white supremacy and extremism in general are a domestic security threat. And if that's the case, then our government needs to be paying attention when experts say that you're seeing chatter that's, increasing white supremacist chatter. We need to pay more attention to those low-level crimes. We need to put the time and resources into investigating those, because those can be an indicator of active extremism in an area.
Well, Dr. Christina Cliff, Assistant Professor of Political Science and Security Studies at Franklin Pierce University, thank you so much for your time and your expertise today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.